get started. We're already in the fifth lesson of this series talking about Jonah. I'm so thankful and determined myself. I just think unworthy to be here before you, but I think more or less I'm just here with you. I had an opportunity to read and study it before I get to present it to you, and the Lord is constantly just speaking to me as I read through these lessons and study throughout the week. So we're still in Jonah. I'm moving on. We've gone through the first 10 verses talking about that, and go ahead and read the key verses we'll talk about in this week's lesson, which is Jonah chapter 1, verses 11 through 16. Jonah 1, 11 through 16. It says, "Then they said unto him, What shall we do unto thee, that the sea may be calm unto us? For the sea wrought and was tempestuous. And he said unto them, Take me up and cast me forth into the sea, so shall the sea be calm unto you. For I know that for my sake this great tempest is upon you. Nevertheless, the men rowed hard to bring it to land, but they could not. For the sea wrought and was tempestuous against them. Wherefore they cried unto the Lord and said, We beseech thee, O Lord, we beseech thee, let us not perish for this man's life, and lay not upon us innocent blood. For thou, O Lord, hast done as it pleased thee. So they took up Jonah and cast him forth into the sea, and the sea ceased from her raging. Then the men feared the Lord exceedingly and offered a sacrifice unto the Lord and made vows." And that's Jonah 1, 11 through 16. As we're reading along there, kind of an overview of what we're talking about today. We're going to be talking about this, again, the lesson title is a chastisement revival. So we're talking about a revival, getting right with the Lord in this sense, how we deal with that. We talked about in the past, some of the things we talked about in chastisement or, for trial or for rebuttal or for, discipline. But also the Lord, again, we talked last week that he can use anything and everything to his hand and power. He's got the whole world in his hands. He can use whatever he feels just to turn us, to set us back on a path. As we're talking about revival, you go back and trace in history some of the great revivals, and they often started because of crisis, death of a prominent person, monetary issues, financial crash, natural disasters. And we even think back in our situation several years ago, back to 9/11, and how there was a turning back to Christ at that time. So this, different things can cause a revival of people to go back and seek the Lord. Beginning, it's still human nature, to listen and to maybe, to bypass the preaching, so to say, and not act or react until the sirens come. It's when something turns to fall, something turns really bad. We hear the warnings, but we don't heed them until something drastic occurs. And that's the situation there. So again, we have to go back to the previous lesson we talked about, listening to the Lord, listening to that still small voice. Listen to us as the Lord speaks to us and calls upon us. And then reacting to that. Don't wait, don't put it off. But we need to make sure that we understand that. Chastisement is never pleasant, especially sometimes as parents, as teachers, even to the one that's handing it down. It's not a pleasant thing. It doesn't please the Lord to chastise his children. It's not to that end. He's not doing that as a way to get you back or to get back at you or whatever. He's not that type of a God. 2 Corinthians 7, 9 through 10 states in part. It says, "Now I rejoice not that ye were made sorry, but that ye sorrowed for repentance. For ye were made sorry after a godly manner." It goes on to say, "For godly sorrow worketh repentance to salvation, not to be repented of." And again, I go back as a parent, and so many things that speak to me to that end. And then as a teacher, a lot of times, catch a child doing something, the first thing they say is, "I'm sorry." But again, you have to go back and realize, are they sorry because they got caught? Which is a lot of the time, because if you not caught them, they'd have gone right on and done. But again, a lot of times they're just sorry because they got caught. And that's not the type of what we need here, what we're talking about. We're talking about that sorrow to repentance. Something that when you repent from it, you're sorry for it, you put it aside, you ask for forgiveness, then you go in a different direction. You don't continue on in that realm. So that's the talk about to that end. So it's being sorrowful to repentance and not just sorry you got caught. It's a total different thing there. So let's pray, and then we'll go ahead and get into this a little bit. Heavenly Father, again, Lord, I thank you so much, Lord, for the opportunity to be here. Lord, I thank you for this church, what it represents. Lord, I thank you for allowing us to move forward. Lord, the decisions coming about us, Lord, again, I pray that you just meet our needs as we seek your face today. Lord, I pray that you would everyone that's here, Lord, thank you for them being here, and those who couldn't be here for whatever reason. Lord, as the teachers prepare their lessons, Lord, study now that they present them, Lord, and please pray, Lord, that you would just speak through us. Lord, help me to be clear and concise in the words you have for me to say, Lord, be able to present it as understandable. Lord, I pray that you help us to get something from this lesson that I already have. Lord, we just pray that you be the pastor that comes later and presents the gospel to us in that form. Lord, pray that you just work in our hearts and our lives. Lord, forgive us when we fail you. Since you say we pray. Amen. So again, we read the text. We talked, these guys are already gone about a lot. They've seen Jonah has run from the Lord. He's hidden on the boat. You know, he's paid. He's done all those things we've studied the last couple of weeks. But again, now we're talking about a change of heart. For him, he's already, he's admitted to those guys, I serve the Lord, the God that created the sea, that created the land. He's done all these things. They're talking about a chastisement of revival. Kind of get the impression when we first read this that these mariners and the guys on the boats, that, the way they go about, they make their vows and they sacrifice the Lord or whatever, that they might have been worshipers all their lives, but probably not. These guys have seen something in their right before them that was presented that probably brought this revival, that brought this change about. Because they're sea hardened, they're seafaring men out there. You've heard the term cussed like a sailor or whatever. So these guys were probably not church going men. But what they've been witness to here at this point in time has brought a change. As we looked at this today, it's brought the change that's coming about. The power of God clearly is seen clearly for the first time in their lives, probably. They haven't been around it much, haven't seen how the Lord has worked, brought the storm about, and then as they cast him over and see the change, it ceased. The winds and the waves obey him, and to be able to see this and understand that, and then when they see the fish later, it's all just going to open them up to that end. So their hearts and lives were in a serious condition. They had issues, and the Lord brought this about through the chastisement, through what happens to Jonah. Affects it. We talk about this too, that where everything we do doesn't just affect us. They're not personal sins, they're not private sins. They affect us. They affect our testimony, which greatly affects others around us. So revival often starts as a result of a trial. Some issue, something goes on there. Jonathan Edwards, gentleman, pointed out that the death of a prominent woman at the beginning of God's mighty work during the first great awakening. Lady passed away there and started that. The famous meeting revival of the mid-1800s. Was spurred by financial crisis, and then the missionary endeavor of William Carey, the printing press and making the Bibles. It was a great fire that destroyed his press and a lot of his work. But because of that, even without the paper, without the press, they were able to present the gospel. Many hearts were changed, lives were changed because of that. Again, it takes crisis. When you look at hospitals, funerals, waiting rooms, foxholes, then come to Christ because of crisis. There's that chastisement, there's that turning around. So whatever the Lord has to use at that time is what he's going to use. So let's get Roman numeral 1. Roman numeral 1 is a sobered reverence. A sobered reverence. This is, by the time we get into verse 16 there, the demeanor of those men has drastically changed. What's been presented to them and what they see. They were very fearful. First they were going about their business, being sailors, doing whatever they had to go aboard in preparation and sailing and going where they were going. But their demeanor has drastically changed. It says, then the men greatly feared the Lord. Before that, they probably didn't give God a second thought. They worshiped their gods, they talked about, they did these things. But when Christ Almighty was presented to them in force so they could see his hand and his power, they changed. They understood that there was something different than what they were seeing. It says, what brought about the humility and hunger for God? It says, looking back through that story, we can come to conclusions about the interest in their spiritual things and how they did that. It says, it was the trial that they were going through, but because of Jonah's chastisement. When the Lord was dealing with Jonah in this situation, it was affecting all of them. And again, he used this chastisement to his end to change these men's hearts as well. So letter A is a fearful conversation, And again, this is the conversation between these men and Jonah as they came about and understood these things. Talking here still in this portion that we're reading and even prior to this, in verses 9 through 11, the conversation between the men, and again, I kept thinking last week too, and then all those questions were popping out. I don't think it was one one guy, I think, with all that were standing around him, you know, who are you, where are you from, why is this happening, and all, I think all of them had this, so it wasn't probably just one man having this conversation, everybody listened, they were all curious and wanted to know. It says, and he said unto them, I am a Hebrew, I fear the Lord, the God of heaven, which hath made the sea and the dry land. It says, then were the men exceedingly afraid, and said unto him, why hast thou done this? And the men knew that he had fled from the presence of the Lord, because he had told them. Then he said unto them, what shall we do unto thee? Or then they said unto him, sorry, he said, what shall we do unto thee, that the sea may be calm unto us? For the sea was wrought and tempestuous. They were mariners. They had been out on the sea before. This probably was not their first cruise. So they had already learned. They knew about rain. They knew about storms and how to deal with it, how to handle it, the proper procedures to go about. But they knew that this storm was different. They knew that the Lord had a hand in it. It was no ordinary storm. Again, they knew that they were in full judgment, and they knew something was going on, and here they were just in this little boat, and it already said that the boat was about to break apart, so they knew that there was something different. They'd never quite been in this situation before. And again, to understand that, it didn't matter if they were in suffering. If the Lord's going to deal with them to that end, he would have been able to work that in. So just because of the boat or whatever situation, the Lord used that, but again, nothing was without his power that he could deal with that. But it's good that they recognized it. They recognized that this is a different situation we've ever been in. I mean, to think the thief on the cross, you know, he recognized this situation where he's at. He's, you know, he's being hung, but he recognizes that Jesus Christ is the one that it's all about. You know, and in his reference, in Luke chapter 23, verses 40 and 41, there I'm going to turn, it says, dost not thou fear God, seeing that thou art in the same condemnation? We indeed justly, for we receive the due reward of our deeds. So he's talking to the other thief, the other guy over there, and he said, look, I said, we're in this situation because of what we did, but we have to understand the situation. It's not because of him, but it's because of us. But we have to realize that. It says, we often sin. It says, we fear getting caught, perhaps paying the consequence. And again, it goes back to what I said with these kids. That's, why are they sorry? Are you sorry you got caught, or are you sorry truly to repentance for what we did? So we have to understand that. In Matthew 10:28, turn here real quick. Matthew chapter 10:28. Matthew 10:28 says, and fear not them which kill the body, but are not able to kill the soul, but rather fear him which is able to destroy both soul and body in hell. So it's understanding, you know, that it's not just the fact that we got caught, but who we serve and why we should fear the Lord in reverence to that end. It says, Jonah would not have done well, or he would have been done well to remember the words of Joshua in Joshua chapter 24 and verse 14 there. It says, now therefore fear the Lord and serve him in sincerity and in truth. Put away the gods which your father served on the other side of the flood and in Egypt, and serve ye the Lord. I remember talking to these gentlemen, they were serving other gods, you know, whatever it was, and how to deal with that. But now the Lord has been presented clearly to them, and so they understand that there's got to be a change coming about. So they are going to have a revival of sorts. So that's a fearful conversation. Letter B is a fatal conclusion. A fatal conclusion. That's letter B. It says, Jonah knew the only hope that these men had saving their lives was to take his. He had already realized that. He came to that realm. The understanding that he knew exactly. He knew he was wrong. He knew he was running. He knew he was hiding. He knew all the situation that he had turned away from the Lord. And he knew it was all because of him. And the only way that they were going to be able to do that was to get him off the boat to save those gentlemen's lives. And he said unto them, take me up and cast me forth into the sea. So shall the sea be calm unto you. For I know that for my sake this great tempest is upon you. So again, that revelation in his heart, his life, he knew. He already had this. The Lord spoke to him. He knew that he was in the wrong. He knew that the whole situation was being caused by his unbelief. And because he did not follow what the Lord had told him to do. He was out of the Lord's will. And again, we have to look at those situations. He didn't plan on this to happen. You know, when he jumped on the boat, there was no situation that he put forth that he's like, okay, I'm going to get on this boat. These bad things are going to happen to these men, so I'm going to do this. He never planned on that. But none of us ever plan to have those type of things happen in our lives. And, you know, when we go about man and woman at the altar, they don't plan to go through what they're going to go just to end the divorce. There's, you know, people don't hold a newborn baby. baby, just knowing that this child's going to run away, you know, when it's 16 years old. People don't plan on those type of things and fall forward, you know. A guy doesn't take his first drink of alcohol knowing that he's going to go head on into someone on a deserted road one night when he's drunk. Because people don't plan or set their courses to that end. But you know, sometimes those things happen. And so we have to understand that. We don't go to those things. We don't, you know, that our sin sometimes can drive us into those situations. But nobody plans that way. Going back to what we already talked about too prior, there's always a cost. There's always a cost of sin. And you may not be the one that pays it either. That's always, we see that too, you know. When a drunk crashes, generally he's not the one that gets hurt or dies. It's somebody else that may have to pay that cost for it. But there's always a cost to sin. And we look in the next, let's see. Galatians 6, we'll turn there in the New Testament, Galatians 6, 7 through 8. Galatians 6. Galatians 6, 7, 8 says, let him that is taught, verse 7 says, be not deceived, God is not mocked, for whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. For he that soweth to his flesh shall of the flesh reap corruption, but he that soweth to the Spirit shall of the Spirit reap life everlasting. So an understanding, you know, and how we deal with this, the way you serve, the way you love, and then where you put your priorities in dealing with this. So nobody ever plans on having issues dealing with these things, but it's where you place your faith, how you deal, and how you serve that we have to understand. Ezekiel 18:20 says, the soul that sinneth shall die. These are the costs. John, 1 John 5:16, there is a sin unto death. So we have to understand that if we don't turn, if we don't repent of these things, it's going to lead to destruction. Whether it takes your life or however it is, understanding that, we have to know and follow. It's still listening when God speaks. That's still small voice when he speaks to you early. And that's the thing. Continue to go back to the references to parents and teachers. But the first time you talk to a child, or you make a little snap of a finger or a look or an eye contact or something, sometimes some kids are good with that. That's all it takes, for goodness, and they understand. Because they have a fear. It's a good fear to know that there's going to be something following you if I don't straighten up. And some kids are hard-headed, and we understand that. And us as adults, same thing. Some of us are hard-headed. We talk about poking you with a toothpick and next thing breaking out the bat. Whatever the words of the deal goes in. So we have to understand that we need to listen and react early to his speaking to us and talking to us so these things don't come about. Roman numeral 2 is a sacrificial reconciliation. A sacrificial reconciliation. It's Roman numeral 2. In verse 16, these men are offering up sacrifice unto the Lord. Probably never have before. Given anything, any type of worship or anything to the Lord. They left the port hours earlier. Again, I don't think they ever had any intentions on having church on the boat, you know, to worship and serve the Lord or making a sacrifice to the Lord. Letter A, under sacrificial reconciliation, letter A is the effort of man. The effort of man. And again, there's no doubt these guys were seasoned mariners, you know, they've on the ship, so they had seen many storms before. And they had a routine, probably, to follow when they got into those situations. This storm, like I said, was different than all the others, but their routine is probably get back to where we came from. And that's what it talks about there. It says, their emergency plan is seen in verse 13. It says, nevertheless, the men rowed hard to bring it to land, but they could not, for the sea wrought and was tempestuous against them. So the first thing they realize is, let's go back where we came from. You know, let's turn around. Let's change this so we don't, you know, we're not having that effect. They've already appealed to their gods. Right? We talked about that. They appealed to their gods. They dumped everything they owned overboard. In verse 5, it says, the mariners were afraid and cried every man unto his god and cast forth the wares that were in the ship into the sea to lighten it up. So they're making their feeble attempts to do what they think is right in this end, but to no avail. True God is sometimes man's last resort. People are down to their luck to the very last edge. They go through everything they can physically or whatever try to do before they actually turn to the Lord and seek him. We didn't, illustrations here, so we try everything we can to rid ourselves of the guilt of sin, but to no avail. And it's going to be us and them. It says we try religion, they tried their gods. It says we try reformation, they tried casting forth the wares. We try good works, they wrote hard, they're trying to put their effort in there. It says, but nothing atones for sin until we go to God. And again, that's with true repentance and a heart that's open to the Lord and try to be receptive to what he has for us. It's just nothing atones for sin until we go to the Lord. Romans 3, 27 and 28. Romans 3, 27 and 28. It says, where is boasting then? It is excluded. By what law? Of works? Nay, but by the law of faith. Therefore, we conclude that a man is justified by faith without the deeds of the law. We can't work through it. We can't buy it. We can't trade for it. We can't do anything. It's faith and trust in Jesus Christ. And it's only through him. Those are the things we have to understand. Then another one, Ephesians 2:8. 2:8, you can probably quote this one. Ephesians 2:8, for by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, and it's the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. So we have to understand to that end. And again, it's only through Jesus Christ, and through faith in him. Just as the unsaved, God's people cannot get through the storms of life on their own. So we're talking about those folks that are unsaved, needing Christ, easily enough through faith. That's all it is. There's no works. There's nothing you can do to justify. You can't buy. You can't light enough candles. You can't, you know, pray enough or whatever. But it's that simple act of faith, putting your faith and trust in Jesus Christ for the unsaved. But again, even as Christians, we need the Lord. Constantly we need the Lord. We still can't understand that through faith in him and then start doing it on our own. Because again, it's not about us. And there's several illustrations in the Bible where it talks about that. In 2 Corinthians 3:5, it says, not that we are sufficient of ourselves to think anything of ourselves, but our sufficiency is of God. Our sufficiency is of God. And then speaking here now to Christians, John 15:5, familiar verse. Let's flip there real quick. John chapter 15 and verse 5. John 15:5, talking about the saved and our connection to the Lord. It says here, it says, I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me, and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit, for without me ye are nothing. So again, without the Lord in our lives, even after we're saved, we have to have his constant walk, that walk of faith and trust in him, that communion with the Lord. It says there, it says, God didn't say that we are or could do something for a little bit without him. He said, you are nothing without me. So let's go back to the reference to that verse. It says, without me, you can do nothing. All right, letter B. Letter B, the elusiveness of mercy. The elusiveness of mercy. It says, upon reaching the conclusion that they could do nothing, these mariners now cast themselves on the mercy of the Lord. So, again, they realize they've done everything they could. They prayed to their gods. They've done all this stuff. They've thrown off everything off the boat. They're rowing, trying to get back to the land, and now that's to no avail. So it says, now it goes back, and they realize, it says, verse 14, it says, wherefore they cried unto the Lord and said, we beseech thee, O Lord, we beseech thee. Let us not perish for this man's life, and lay not upon us innocent blood, for thou, O Lord, has done as pleased thee. So they're realizing to that end that there's nothing they can do. And they're going to the Lord, we beseech thee, O Lord, we beseech thee. They're basically saying, have mercy on us. What can we do? They also realize they had to make a decision. As Jonah's already said, the only way to end this is to throw me overboard. To throw a man overboard in a sea that's like that, they know that there's no end for him except death. And so now they're realizing too, okay, what if this is not the case? How are we going to deal with this? So they're going to the Lord to ask for this. It says God's mercy doesn't come on our terms, and it's the Lord gives us that grace. We have to understand the difference between the grace and the mercy. One of the things that I've taught or I've seen in the past too, that grace is God giving us what we don't deserve. That's God's grace. He gives us what we don't deserve. But God's mercy is him withholding what we do deserve. So as we think about that, grace is him giving us what we don't deserve. Mercy is him not giving us what we do deserve. He gives us that mercy. Because if he gave us what we just deserved, none of us would be here today. So we have to understand that. God's mercy doesn't come on our terms. God does not negotiate his grace. There's only one way to heaven, and that is through Jesus Christ. The sooner people realize that, the better. John 14:6. That's another familiar passage. John 14:6. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. And it's that simple. Just simple faith in Jesus Christ. 2 Chronicles goes there and says the formula for revival is straightforward. 2 Chronicles, the Old Testament, 2 Chronicles 7:14. It says, if my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray, seek my face, and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from them, and will forgive their sin, and will heal their land. And again, that's been a mantra throughout the election time. You've heard people pray and talk about it. But it's a daily walk, and we have to understand that. Again, this country is not in the shape that it's in, or our lives aren't in the shape they're in because of the unsaved folks. Remember that. It's the Christians that are going to have an effect on people. The way we live, our testimony, and the things that we say, and the things that we do. And again, it's talking about in my people. And this all falls back on the saved. Are we living the lives we're supposed to live? Do we have that testimony before men? Are we doing what we're supposed to do? Being active and being forward and present the gospel of Christ. That's going to be the change. And again, when we humble ourselves and realize that it's just through God and through God alone, those changes can come about. Isaiah 55, we can flip there in the Old Testament. Isaiah 55:6-7. Isaiah 55:6-7. It says, seek ye the Lord while he may be found, and call ye upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return unto the Lord, and he will have mercy upon him, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. And again, it's turning from your wicked ways and make that repentance. And again, it's not just being sorry for sorry's sake, but being sorry, truly sorry, to repent, to turn away, and to ask for the Lord's forgiveness. Right. Roman numeral 3. Roman numeral 3 is a surrendered resolve. A surrendered resolve. Again, in chapter or verse 16, there, so we read these men in the middle of the storm, they made vows. You know, they talk about the Lord, they vow to the Lord for whatever it is. You know, a lot of people say that, we'll make a deal or whatever, and say, Lord, if you do this for me, I'll do this or whatever. But it's basically a vow, and they're willing to serve him at this point, but that's what they're talking about. Because there's so many times that, you know, people say no to God in church, but then they'll say yes to him in crisis. Have to realize that too. So many times, like I said, we've already mentioned it, at the hospital or at a funeral or in different situations where people are going to be more receptive to God's word because of that situation. You know, they're either broken or humbled, and they're actually at that point in time, the pride is gone. It's all been wiped away because of the situation. And they're able to hear the Lord and they're able to accept it at that end. So, letter A. Letter A is a serious moment. A serious moment. Jonah 1:15 there says, so they took up Jonah and cast him forth into the sea, and the sea ceased from her raging. That was definitely pretty much a serious moment. They grabbed him and threw him overboard to that end. And these men were fearful. And you have to realize just how bad was it. Don't know the size of the boat. There were quite a few of them. It was a big enough boat that he was down in and down into the sides. So it must have been a fairly large vessel. This isn't just a little skipper, little boat out there that get tossed about. It must have been a pretty good-sized boat or a pretty good-sized ship. And for these guys to be that fearful of what's going on, to actually pick a man up and throw him overboard, I couldn't even imagine the fear in these men's hearts and what they were going through, that this boat was about to break apart. So they actually threw him overboard. Again, it says taking the life of another. It's a serious crime. It's a serious act. Some people have no heart or heartless to that end, just don't care. They don't care about themselves, so they don't care about others. But for regular people, I mean, it's an act that's unbelievable to be able to make that, you know, in a conscious thought to be able to do that instead of acting in the moment. It says Genesis 9:6 makes a reference to that, talking about it being a crime. It says, whoso sheddeth man's blood, by man shall his blood be shed. For the image of God made he man. So those guys realized that we're making a mistake here. We were murderers. We just threw a guy overboard. So they had to understand, and they made that decision of what he said and the fact that they were scared to death. They never, never been a situation that they had there, whether it was a hurricane type gale or what they were in, but they knew that they had to make this decision. Christian life is not a game. We talk about making vows. When we do these things, as when we walk an aisle and make a decision, it's an important matter. And that's what these guys have made a vow. So we're talking about the serious moment where they vowed a vow. In Ecclesiastes chapter 5 and verse 4. Ecclesiastes 5, 4 through 5. It says, when thou vowest a vow unto God, defer not to pay it, for he hath no pleasure in fools. Pay that which that thou hast vowed. Better is it that thou shouldest not vow than that thou shouldest vow and not pay. So it's a serious business to go before the Lord and to say, Lord, I'm going to do this. Lord, help me, receive me, do these things, Lord, and I will do this. And it's saying here, you'd be better off to not do that if you're not going to stick with what you said. So it's a serious business what these guys are doing in these decisions, that serious moment, to make those vows and to understand that, you know, what they did, they threw him over, and then pulling back now to the Lord and say, look, we're going to make a vow, we're going to do this. And that was probably some of the things they were talking about, saying, Lord, look, we're going to throw him over if, or whatever. So, but the Bible says, you're better off to not make those vows or these decisions. You know, you get emotional, however the Lord's speaking to you, the Holy Spirit's on your heart, when the pastor's preaching, whatever, you think about some of the things in your life, come down here and bow the knee and pray and say, Lord, please help me with this, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that, and then get up and walk away, and those changes never come about. It's serious business before the Lord. You come down here and pour your heart and soul out to him, and then never seek him again about that and ask him to help you on your daily walk to put things aside, whether, you know, whatever these secret sins or the things, you know, little things in our hearts and our lives that we don't think that are a big deal. But that's what he's talking about. It's a serious business. Second Peter, in 2 Peter chapter 2 and verse 21, the New Testament towards the back, 2 Peter 2:21 says, for it had been better for them not to have known the way of righteousness than after they have known it to turn from the holy commandment delivered unto them. In other words, they're talking here about making a vow, going before the Lord, and then turning your back on it, turning your heart away from it. He said it would be better off to not even do it at all because of the judgment and chastisement that could come upon you. And letter B, and this is Roman number 3, a surrender resolve. Letter B is a supernatural miracle. A supernatural miracle. Once they threw him over, he got, I mean, there's always, when you read these stories, whatever, most of us have heard them since we were kids, but how did the whole situation pan out? You know, I mean, when they pitched him over, do you think they all just stood there? Where do you think they all went? They all went to the edge. They wanted to see, you know, what's happened. But it also says that as soon as they threw him over, that it was calm, that they stopped. Because, you know, they had to think about, you know, was he going to survive or not survive, or what was going to happen when we throw him overboard. They thought he was just a good swimmer and he could hang, or how it was going to go. But remember, when they first threw him over, the gale force was still there. It was tempestuous. It was all in a bad situation. But it says immediately that it calmed. So at that point in time, you had to wonder what they were thinking about. It says here that it says, perhaps they hoped he was a good swimmer and couldn't survive until God appeased the storm. It says, on the other hand, they no doubt had seen men go overboard before, only to quickly drown under the waves of a fierce sea. But the shining moment for them at this point, to realize if the Lord wasn't in the storm, he had to be in the fish. The very next verse says, in Jonah 1:17, it says, now the Lord had prepared a great fish to swallow up Jonah. I'm sure you guys, some of you that are internet savvy, might look at YouTube and you see some of these things, and you know, and that's the thing, people will be going along, or somebody's fishing. Some of the ones I like to see are these guys are fishing, and he's got nice fish, and they go, oh, look, and they're reeling it in, and all of a sudden, a bigger fish comes along and takes that fish, you know, to that end, and that's probably what they were doing. They may have pitched him over, sea calm, and they're like, he's going to be okay. And then the very next thing, you know, what happened to that end? So the things that they were looking at, the things that they were wondering, it just, you know, I guess you had to be there. There's so many things that you're going to get to find out when you go to heaven, and the conversations you can have with these people to that end. But they had to understand, it says, the Lord prepared a great fish to swallow up Jonah. Everybody been to SeaWorld at least once? You sit there in preparation, go to the big show, you sit there watching, and they always let the fish out sooner, or you know, the big orcas or whatever. But to see one of those guys come up and see their size and their magnitude, they're huge. To that end, and to understand what the Lord had prepared. Now, we don't know what kind of fish it was. Later in the New Testament, the Lord says a whale. Actually, Jesus Christ was talking, and he actually said a whale when he talks about Jonah. And here it just says a great fish. So we know it was a huge fish. It says, but to understand that this huge mammal or whatever it was, and a whale coming, that the Lord had prepared, he set everything aside, set everything in order to be a witness to these men on board his ship. He's chastising Jonah, for his disbelief, for his disobedience. But he used everything in that around there as a testimony to speak to these men. He sees, he had the raging sea, and he calmed the sea. And now this other thing he says before them, for them to pitch him over and for this fish to come. And if they didn't believe it in the storm, they had to believe it in the fish that came and took him away. So we have to understand the Lord can use anything, and he will. He'll use anything and everything available to him to be able to be a witness or a tool his end and to his end and what he wants of his glory. Picture comes to mind as I read the passage there talking about the big fish. It says that these men didn't believe that God was behind the storm. They had to believe that God was controlling the whale. So it says, no wonder, as we read in verse 16, then the men feared the Lord exceedingly and offered a sacrifice unto the Lord and made vows. So immediately, they understood and they believed. Even as soon as they pitched him overboard, there was a celebration in their hearts. They realized it was the God. They made a sacrifice, and they made vows to the Lord. So I'm thinking, pretty much all those guys probably got saved on the boat that day. They saw God's power, they saw his magnitude of what he could do, and that he had the whole world in his hands. So they're talking about how they made a sacrifice unto the Lord, and then they made those vows. But again, it's just so many times that we have to wait for that crisis before we make a change in our lives. And how the Lord speaks to us constantly or daily, push things before us to remind us, little things we hear, little things we say, our daily devotions, if we're true to the Lord in that end, how he will speak to us and try to bring us to repentance and some of those things. And again, it's not all this big sins that we always talk about that other people do. We're talking about just things that our thoughts, our mindset, our attitude, our bitterness, or the way that we feel about others, or that we act, or according to others. It's just the Lord can set those things aside. If we seek him, if we ask for his help on a daily basis, read our Bible and seek him and let him speak to us through his word, that's where he's going to talk to us most of the time. But again, through actions and deeds of others, a lot of times he'll speak to us and let us know to that end. In Romans 2:4, Romans asks there in Romans 2:4, it says, or despisest thou the riches of his goodness and forbearance and long suffering, not knowing that the goodness of God leadeth thee to repentance. So if we can put our trust and our faith in him and rely on him to all these things and repent. When we've done wrong, again, don't keep a long list with the Lord. So when you have a thought, you're in the car driving, something, and you have a bad thought about the driver next to you, these little things and all that, right then ask the Lord for forgiveness. Say, Lord, please help me with that. Give me a better attitude for that. Don't let me speak out. Don't let me react that way. In anything, some of the more harder sins, the physical sins, the things that we can't put down and can't lay aside. Every time you think about it, seek the Lord's face instead in these things. Make those commitments to the Lord and then stick to them. When we make a vow, when we make those things, when we come down and pray to the Lord, we want to seek him. Because again, without him, we're nothing. We can do nothing without him in our lives. We have to do that. We cannot do it in and of ourselves. Be able to say, okay, I'm going to get this, I'm going to do this. These guys tried. They're like, storm's there, shore's there, they rowed, they pulled the oars, and they couldn't move. They couldn't go anywhere against the Lord. So they have to realize that. It's only through him that we can do those things. It says, it may not seem as critical, it says, but it surely is easier to make decisions for God when we're on dry land instead of being on the boat when things were rough. So we have to understand and realize that. So let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we love you. Thank you for the opportunity to be here. Lord, we thank you for Jonah, Lord, the story you put in the Bible, Lord, to help us understand, Lord, to seek you, Lord, to listen to you when you first speak to us, Lord, that still small voice, the nudging, Lord, to be able to react at that time, to seek you, Lord, to ask for forgiveness, Lord, to get back in your will, Lord, to seek your will on a day-to-day basis, Lord, and strive to do that with your help, Lord, knowing that without you we can. Lord, so thank you for the time that you give me to study, put this in the heart, Lord, I pray that you just help these folks, whether they speak clearly, they get something from it themselves, or they can take for practice on a day-to-day basis. Right now, that you can hear the rest of the classes, Lord, and those teachers and the students as well, Lord, help them take something from it. Pray for the ministry next door, Lord, the Spanish ministry, that those folks will be able to grow, continue to witness and be a light here in this community, Lord. Pray for the next hour, Lord, as we worship you in song, help us to sing out, Lord, and lift our voices to you, be the pastors, and prepare a message for us for you. Lord, we're so thankful for you allowing us to be here and all we have. Lord, continue to meet our needs, help us to seek you, and we'll be thankful for it. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.